Hey.
I'm good. How are you? So I wanted to start off by just, I don't know if you've taken the exam yet. Okay, so I wanted to talk a little bit about the exam. If anybody comes in that has taken the exam, I'm going to tell them that if they have questions about specific questions, they can't ask them. That's fine. I just, like I said, if somebody had already taken the exam and they had a question about a question, because there are people that haven't taken the exam, I can't answer those. So, oh, that's good. That's good. Well, midterm's enough. So I just wanted to, I kind of put a note out about this, or not, I did put a note about this. I just wanted to expand on a little bit. So the questions come from the chapters 1 through 6. They also come from the labs. So this question's about, tools, oh, if you were in this situation, what might be the tool that you would use to try and use to solve the problem? So they're all, so they're from the labs, the tools that we used in the labs. That's no problem. Well, the ones on the tools were based on the labs. So, and if there's more than one tool that I felt was valid, then it's a multiple answer question. And if I felt that there was a tool that was more valid than anything else, and and I try to be very careful about that. There's a couple of true and false, but it's almost, otherwise it's all multiple choice. Right. And I try not to, with questions like that, CompTIA is pretty good about, questions. If they want a single answer, it's hard to argue that another tool or device is better. But with Cisco, just if you ever think about taking a Cisco exam, you need to know a little bit about the philosophy of the company, because sometimes the Cisco exams will ask a question, and there may be multiple tools that you feel would be the right one. But if there's only one answer, you need to know what Cisco thinks would be the most right one to get the answer right. I try not to ask questions like that.
The most right one. That sounds great.
So if you're taking a specific vendor certification exam, then you need to know a little bit about how the vendor thinks about the stuff that's involved in the certification exam. CompTIA, their goal is to be neutral. And so they typically, if they are going to put questions out there where more than one tool is right, then they're multiple answer. And with my tests, you get partial credit. With CompTIA, if it's a multiple answer, you either have to get all of the things that they think are right, or there's no credit. So that's just kind of a thing about taking a certification exam, as opposed to taking my, I try to make my test similar to the experience of taking the certs, but I do give partial credit, and CompTIA doesn't. So that is one thing to be aware of if you're thinking about a cert. So you make sure you, if you're taking a cert, that you pay attention to whether or not it's a multiple answer question. And if I remember right, it's been a while since I've taken a cert, But if I remember right, typically, if there's one answer, it's a radio button. So it's a circle. And if it's a multiple answer, it's a box. And when you click in the box, it either puts a check mark or an X, I forget what. But so that's kind of one of the things that are a heads up. If it, and I think Moodle does the same thing. If it's multiple answer, I think it's a box. And if it's a single answer, it's a radio button. But it'll also say multiple answer. I only have maybe three multiple answer questions on the midterm. Most of them are single answer. So the best way to prepare for the test, you know, I wouldn't sit down and read chapter 1 through 6 this week. But I would look over the chapter summaries and look at the review questions, because some of the questions on the exam are based on the review questions at the end of the chapter. In fact, a lot of questions on the exam are based on the review questions. I rewrote some of them. So, you know, because the CompTIA exams, they love to give you scenarios. So this is the situation, you know, they'll say, you've noticed a network performance slowdown, and you've recently added a large number of workstations, and you have some legacy hubs on the network. What might be the device that you would install to improve network performance? And of course, with that scenario, the answer is a switch. But if they said, oh, you're on a completely switched network, you've recently added workstations, and now you have, you know, even though in theory, you know, you can have not in a straight class C, but, you know, if you supernet a class C, you know, you could have 1,024 devices on a subnet. You never want to get that high, because they'll, especially in IPv4, because you would have enough broadcast to seriously impact the performance of your network. So if it was like, oh, well, you just added 100 workstations to bring your total to 900 clients on the network, and you've noticed a performance slowdown, what might you do to improve performance? And one of the answers was, well, install layer 3 switches and create VLANs. That would probably be the answer. Because then you would make your, you know, you would create more subnets, you'd make the collision domains smaller, you know. So they love those scenario kinds of questions. So some of the questions that I adapted from the end of the chapter, I turned into scenario questions. So it's not a straight copy and, what you know, and put straight into the exam as written. But there, you know, by looking at the questions at the end of the chapter, that will be very helpful. You know, I mean, my goal in a test is not to sandbag anybody. And, you know, and if you decide you want to prep for taking a cert, you know, the best way to prep for that is by answering like chapter summary questions, do practice tests, you know, obviously have either taken a class or read the book so that you know the material. But once you feel like you have a handle on the material, just by answering questions over and over again to get a feel for what it's going to be like to take the cert, that is the best way to prepare for a certification exam. And so I know that not everybody's going to take the cert at the end of this class, and that's fine. But at the end of this class, if you feel like you've really grasped the material and you're doing well on the test, and you're like, I'm coming to the end of my education and I really want to launch my career and I want that cert, once you've taken the final, my final is very similar to the actual cert. And then you can say, if you do really well on the final, okay, maybe I'm ready. Although I would take a couple of practice tests at one of the testing centers before you sign up for the test, just to be sure. But if you like, score a 65, you might, you know, on the final, you might say, okay, I feel like I have a handle on the material, but in order to be able to answer the questions to pass a cert, I need to take more practice tests, you know, and so that'll tell you that. So that, you know, that's kind of, you know, test taking strategies and how to, you know, prepare. As I said, you know, there are several questions related to the tools that we used in labs. And so, and I may have mixed metaphors. I don't think I did, but I'm not going to swear that I didn't, because I recently did Wireshark with my LAN class. And I was thinking that we had already done Wireshark, and I was going through for tonight and realized, oh, Wireshark is next week. But Wireshark is a packet capture tool. And that's the other thing that I wanted to go over tonight, since, you know, the way our rhythm works, our next conference is a week from Sunday, which is before the Wireshark assignment is due, but it's like the, you know, the day before it's due. So I was going to walk through Wireshark a little bit tonight. Do you have any questions about the exam? As I said, when I write exams, I don't try to write them in a way that's tricky, and, you know, trying to force you into making an incorrect decision. I know some teachers, at least when I was a student, really like to write questions like that to see if you really knew the material. And I don't think that all of the, you know, not all of the questions are overly easy. You know, you need to know the material, but to try to write things that deliberately catch you up, I think that's silly. It's not what I try to do. So, right. So, and if you discover there's a problem with the test, you know, that I accidentally used a question twice. I did that but once in the past. You know, when I was tired and, you know, toward the end of writing the test, because this is a completely new test from what I've done. I deleted all of my old tests, and I've written all new ones. So if you discover there's a glitch with a question where it looks like the wrong answer is marked as the right answer or something like that, drop me a note and ask me about it and say, you know, I ran into this question and I thought this was the right answer. Is that right? And if it is right, because it doesn't make sense to me, can you explain it to me? And I'll be happy to do that. And if I made a mistake and I marked the right thing wrong, then everybody gets credit for the question. So, yeah. So if I have an error in the test, I would A, like to know so I can fix it for next time, and B, you know, if you think it was an error, but I think it's not, I'll explain why I think it's not an error, and just so that we're all on the same wavelength. So Wireshark
is a quick question about the exam, if you don't mind.
No, go ahead.
I just wanted to double check. It's not timed, is it?
No. So So, you know, tests and quizzes, except for the final that I give, you know, I changed the quizzes as of this semester in security. I used to give objective quizzes that were multiple choice, and I decided to drop those because I felt like the policy stuff was more important, and I felt like there were people that were A, overwhelmed with all of the policies in the final project, even though I would say at the beginning of the class, you should work on these a little bit at a time as we touch on them and the topics related to them in the reading and in conferences. Invariably, you know, people being what they are and liking to procrastinate and being the pressure of a deadline, people would put them off to the last minute and not always do enough due diligence. And, you know, a big thing about security is having policy in place to back you up, because if you don't have a policy that says that's not okay, and you took disciplinary action in the workplace, the people could have a case to say it wasn't against company policy. And, you know, you could open yourself up to legal action. And so if you think something shouldn't be okay, then you should have a policy that spells that out. And I know I mentioned this in some conference. I don't remember if it was a Sunday or a Wednesday. You know, there was a case. It was around the first time I taught the security class. Maybe it was even before then. It had to have been before then, because it was in the days when Napster was doing illegal downloads. I remember there was this case where a woman was working at a corporation, and she was downloading MP3s. And IT knew she was downloading MP3s, and IT didn't seem to have a problem with it. In fact, at one point, she was running out of space on her hard drive, and she asked for additional storage, and IT gave her an additional drive to put her MP3s on. And then later on, she got fired, and she was justifiably confused. She said there was no policy against it. IT was fully aware of what I was doing. So she was in court. IT was fully aware of what I was doing, and they gave me additional storage for more music files because I was listening to music while I worked. And I did not hear how the case turned out, but she had a pretty strong case. And, you know, back in the early 2000s, you know, this was probably 2003, 2004. A lot of companies did not have acceptable use policies, never mind full-blown security policies. And so, you know, the company could have said, well, you know, these were copyrighted material, they were illegal downloads. But the company was in a weak position legally, especially since she was getting support from one part of the company to do what she was doing, and then got fired by another part of the company for what she was doing. The company was really not in a good legal position. So a lot of security is about having the proper policy in place to back you up. You know, and that helps make things clear to everyone. You know, and then there was a case, I mentioned this in a conference too, where somebody hacked into one of the University of California campus servers, and they got the message of the day that said, "Welcome to the University of California," at whatever site it was. And they used as their defense in court that it said welcome, so I thought it was okay for me to be there, and they won. And so most people changed their message of the day to read, you know, this computer system is the property of blah, 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 blah. If you are not an authorized user, you need to log out immediately. You know, violators will be prosecuted to the full extent of the law, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, to part of protecting your data is making sure that the policy is in place to help you protect your data. Because if the policy is not backing you up, and somebody does something that you're like, well, that's really not cool. Well, it may not be cool, but it may not be against company policy, and it may not be illegal. And so you have to change policy before you can. You know, especially if you have a user that's really headstrong, you have to change policy before you can really push that user to change. Because if they're headstrong and dug in, they may, you know, they could, you know, create a legal battle if they so wanted to. And so that's why I changed the policies to to quizzes, because I just felt like, and then it's not, if you've already done some and gotten a feel for it, by the time you get to doing your final project and you're going to be working on policies that maybe weren't required for the quizzes, you've got a feel for what it is, you know, like the most common comment I made about the most recent batch of policies was, there were some people that didn't take out the SANS logo, didn't take out the thing that said, you know, these policies are available for free use, feel free to modify it, blah, 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 blah. You, as an organization, if you're going to use those templates, you got to take ownership and make it your own. And so you don't want to have the SANS logo in there and say, this is from SANS. This, you know, should be, you know, Dave's Widget Company. And, you know, this is the policy of Dave's Widget Company. And SANS expects you to do that. It's not like doing academic citation. This is, it's why SANS provides the policy, so that you can take the policy, adapt it, put in your company name. You don't have to reference SANS at all in the policy. Saying InfoSec is fine because that's information security. And if the company's big enough, you're going to have an information security team. So, you know, leaving references to InfoSec is fine, but you don't really want to leave references to SANS and the little stuff that's all in italics that talks about, oh, this is free, you know, make nice use of this for your company. And it should look professional and look like it's from your company. All of the policies, when you turn in your final project, all of the policies should look like that. that's really important. And, you know, a lot of people didn't change very much in the wireless policies, and that kind of didn't surprise me. The wireless policies are, unless you really want to have an open network for some reason, an open public network, the level of encryption and, not doing SSID broadcasts, and, you know, that's all good security policy. And most people left that as it was. There were some of the people that were doing the school scenario did say, oh, we're going to have a public part of the network for parents and guests that come into the school for school events. And, you know, it's going to be open, and but it's only going to have access to the internet. There will be no access to the private part of the network. And that's fine. You know, so it's really, you know, you adapt the policy to fit the scenario that you're working in. So, all right. So let's do a quick little demo of Wireshark. Wireshark is really cool. So, oh, let me share it if I haven't shared it yet. Wireshark. Okay, so get that out of the way. Okay, so all you have to do, you can either go up to capture and say start, or you can click on the shark fin and it will start capturing packets. And because we have a conference going, there's going to be a lot of packets. So I'm going to stop capturing packets because there's quite a few going. And, you know, kind of the first thing to look at is what's the protocol. You got UDP, TCP, UDP, that typically if you're doing audio or video streaming, it uses UDP because there's no error checking. There's a little bit of overhead with error checking. And then if it receives a packet out of order, you know, it's going to want to wait to find the right packet so they can assemble it all in the right order. And that takes time. And, you know, whereas, you know, things coming across in real time, like audio and video, it's considered better to have a little glitch rather than having this overhead of all the error checking that goes on in TCP. So UDP is usually the preferred protocol for streaming services. But we can sort based on protocol. There's all the TCP, there's all the UDP, and oh, and then up here, I'm not sure what DCERPC, I'd have to look that up. What's surprising to me is that we don't see any ARPs, and maybe it's just because the duration was so short. So ARP is address resolution protocol. It's a broadcast, but it's required for TCP IP version 4 to work. What ARP does is it maps IP addresses to MAC addresses. And there's reverse ARP, which maps MAC addresses to IP addresses. And those are both broadcasts. So if your network were slow, for example, you might fire up Wireshark and see if you have large number of broadcasts. And it would say broadcast here. And if you have a lot of broadcasts, then, you know, you'd want to look at what is it that's broadcasting. Most networks these days have standardized on TCP/IP. You know, Apple views Apple Talk as a legacy protocol. Novell, which is no longer an independent company, they were bought by somebody else. They view IPX/SPX as a legacy protocol. And Microsoft views NetBUI as a legacy protocol. Now, NetBUI wasn't routable. Both AppleTalk and IPX/SPX were. But all three of those did a lot of broadcasting. They were all very chatty. And if you have legacy equipment floating around on your network, particularly printers, you know, network printers 10, 15 years ago, they would have NetBUI, IPX/SPX, AppleTalk, and TCP/IP, and by default they were all enabled. So somebody might not be using AppleTalk or think they weren't using AppleTalk, for example. You know, they're like, oh yeah, we're a pure IP network, and they just pop their printers on and not verify what the protocols were enabled. And then they would see that there were these IPX/SPX, NetBUI, and AppleTalk broadcasts going on. And that would be causing the network to slow down, especially if they were broadcasting for nothing because you weren't using the protocols. And, you know, when I was working full-time in school IT, I occasionally would have network administrators say, oh, yeah, we're running pure IP now. And sometimes I would say, are you sure? And I said, because I thought I was running pure IP at one point, and I discovered that I wasn't. When Wireshark first came out, it was called Ethereal. They changed its name to Wireshark. And so I started using Wireshark before it was called Wireshark. And I was like, yeah, I discovered this free packet capture tool. And I said, I found printers broadcasting IPX/SPX and NetBUI and AppleTalk. And that until I went and turned that off, I was not yet pure IP. So if you were to inherit a network and you had legacy devices on the network, particularly printers, I would definitely fire up Wireshark and see if you have protocols that you're not using that are enabled, that are just spewing out data. Because the more devices you have on the network, broadcasts are going to create collisions. You know, on an Ethernet network, only one computer can transmit at a time. And if two computers transmit at the same time, there's a collision. They both stop transmitting, wait a random amount of time, and then they try again. So if you have stuff that's unnecessarily broadcasting on the network, even if it's a different protocol, there's going to be a collision. Transmission will stop. The devices that were involved in the collision will wait a random amount of time and try again. And if you got these broadcasts going on, they have to find a space between the broadcasts to get their data out there. So looking at your traffic and seeing any broadcasts that you can eliminate is a good thing. If you run NetBIOS on TCP/IP. NetBIOS is chatty and does a fair amount of broadcasting. So NetBIOS is what populates my network places. So if you go and browse a network, there are broadcasts that come out of NetBIOS to help you find devices. And but the other thing from a troubleshooting point of view, if all of a sudden your network's running smooth, you know, and you haven't installed any new devices, not made any significant changes, and then all of a sudden you experience a slowdown, you could fire up Wireshark and you might discover that there's a worm probing all the devices on your network, and that's causing the slowdown. I got called in for a consult at Cabot School one time, and they were an all Mac school, but the librarian had wanted to put the card catalog out on the internet. And at the time they did that, their network guy was a Mac guy. School board member said, "Oh, well, I know Windows," and he bought Server 2000 and put the card catalog on, but he didn't put any antivirus software, he didn't apply any patches, and he didn't run the lockdown tool in Server 2000. And it was infected with a worm within 2 days of going live. And the worm was generating so much traffic across the internet connection that nobody could get out. They were not getting anything across their internet connection. And so running a tool like Wireshark would discover those kinds of probes. You know, if you're on a switch network, you're only going to see broadcasts or attempts to connect to your machine. You're not going to see, you know, traffic from, you know, the workstation next to you sending data to a printer, unless you use a monitoring port. If you enable a monitoring port on the switch, you can capture all the traffic that is going through the switch. If you do that, you want to make sure you have some ethics, because, you know, if somebody does a clear text authentication and you're capturing all the packets, you could actually look at their username and password, because I didn't show you can look deeper into the packet, you know, so you can look at the frame type, it see that it's an Ethernet 2, you know, if this were not, didn't have encryption going on, we're seeing a lot of, some hex going on here. We actually might see down here, if I did a clear text authentication, a username and password in the data part of the packet. So, which is kind of cool and kind of scary. So there are reasons to monitor all the traffic going through a switch. Make sure that if you do it, that you're authorized to do it. You know, if you just like, oh, well, this would be a good idea, and you haven't thoroughly studied security policy for the company, and you haven't gotten proper authorization, it could be causes for termination of your position. So use a tool like this with caution. Oh, and don't run it on the CCV network. If you're at CCV, particularly in Winooski, if you run Wireshark during the day, I can bet you Charlie Bombard will be there to see you within 10 minutes, because they have IDS, and that will tell them that a sniffer is in the works, and it will tell them what switch it's plugged into and what workstation off the switch is. And I had somebody do that from one of my classes. English was not his first language, and I tried to be really clear about not running it on the CCV network, but he didn't understand that, and he was doing the Wireshark assignment like the next day, and he started running Wireshark, and within 10 minutes Charlie was there to speak to him about it, and Charlie sent me a rather stern email about the fact that my students were running Wireshark on the CCV network. And I said, well, I told him not to do that. I said, do you understand? English is not his first language. He probably misunderstood the instructions. So powerful tool. If you wanted to see a clear text authentication, if you ran a little simple FTP program and connected on your own machine and then connected to it to yourself and captured the data while you do it, you'd be able to see the username and password, which is kind of cool. So a lot to learn in this tool. It'll take some getting, you know, deciphering all of this stuff takes practice. But just to see everything that's going on initially is pretty cool. Like right here, this one, you know, it says a bind act. So the bind is, that's a DNS thing. Bind is Berkeley Internet Name Domain. And ACK is an acknowledgement. And then it says over here, the packet's malformed, which is interesting. Aha. That must be what this DCERPC is. I got to look this up. Because this looks, that one's a problem packet. Ah. Well, I knew RPC was, but what about the DCE? Because RPC is a remote call. That's pretty standard, but the DCE. Yeah, I'm going to look that up later. So we're almost out of time. So, just run this on your own LAN. And if you just open up if you start it and open up a web page, you're going to get a ton of data just from the web page loading. Because, you know, you all know when you open a web page, it's actually multiple calls to the server to load the graphics and all of the text and so on and so forth. If there are ads, you know, in fact, some of the stuff that's on the page may not even be from the original web server. If they're using an ad service, the ads may be coming from some other server completely different. So you'll just opening a web page will give you a ton of data. If you run this when you're not doing much, you'll see a little bit of stuff, and you will see the ACKs, the ARPs and the reverse ARPs and some of the other broadcasts that are normal part of networking. But if you're watching it scroll by, filling up with data, if you're not in a conference and your other network is otherwise quiet, that's probably suspicious. You might have, if you haven't just opened up a web page, you're not in a conference, and you don't have a lot of other devices on your network, you might want to check to see if you've got a worm. Because when I run this, when I'm not in conference and not opening up a page, you know, it'll get to the bottom here within a couple of seconds. But if I'm in the middle of a conference, you saw how quickly it went to the bottom. You know, it filled up really fast. A couple seconds is actually a long time before you get to the bottom here. And if you have a home network and you can enable a monitoring port on your switch, which if you're running DDWRT is a firmware replacement. It's a Linux firmware replacement for consumer model wireless routers. You can enable one of the Ethernet ports to be a monitoring port, and you could capture everything that's going across your network just if you're curious to see what's different. But it's a pretty cool tool. Definitely standard tool in the toolbox, either whether it's Wireshark or some other packet sniffer. So. And any other questions? Sure. Oh, and did you see my note about the antivirus? Where, because I had trouble reading the orange on black. Can you just send me a copy of the file? Just send it as an attachment. Because I was like, there's a lot here, and my eyes are having trouble with this orange on black. Okay. So, yeah, just send me a copy of the file. Okay, great. All right. I think that's it, unless you have other questions. All right. I'm going to stop the share, and we can call it a night. And our next one's a week from...